Welcome everyone to our weekly call. Hope you've all had a restful weekend. New week starts off fresh as always. Just a quick reminder of our agenda for the call today. So I just pop my my slide back on the screen so you can see that. So main focus for the discussion, Mallory will just talk through a presentation on encryption end runs, legal challenges from around the world, which I know this was recommended to me, Mallory, from your presentation at Real World Crypto, that it was definitely worth repeating. So you have fans, but you knew that. Mary will sort of give a presentation as always. We'll sort of take questions and comments on that. So Arno at least will be using the Zoom raise hands facility. Now he's an expert in that. Anyone that isn't in a position to talk but wants to sort of pass a comment or ask a question, just put them in the chat. I'll be happy to read them out on your behalf. And then after that, as always, I'll just sort of run through a few recent developments and forthcoming events and future call topics and anything else that anyone wants to raise whilst we're on the call, time permitting, obviously. So without further ado, let me stop sharing. For anyone that hasn't met Mallory, Mallory, you're CTO of the Center for Democracy and Technology. Currently, having, I think before that Article 19 and before that, I'm sure all sorts of other really interesting things as well. Mallory comes from civil society, but with a technology background, which I think is a great mix, certainly in the ITF, therefore we'll sort of run through this week be a more policy orientated topic as we've been more technology orientated for the last few weeks. So without further ado, Mallory, hand over to you and sort of look forward to the presentation.
Hi, thanks for having me. As you said, I'm CTO here in Washington with the Center for Democracy and Technology. Here we do technology policy, and also we have an office in Brussels. I'm also on the Internet Architecture Board and am active in the Internet Engineering Task Force in general. So this topic around end-to-end encryption certainly can sometimes apply to other forms of encryption, but at Real World Crypto, that was sort of the main topic. And I'm just looking forward to having a bit of a conversation with you all, getting your comments and feedback on it as well. This is a reprieve. And Andrew, sorry, can you remind me how long you'd like me to talk for so that I don't ramble? Because I could talk about this all day.
Sure. So 25 minutes or so. So to around half past the hour, a bit after that, we won't be rigid on time. As long as it's interesting, keep going, Mallory.
All right. Well, we can get into probably a lot more interesting discussion. So I'll try to keep the presentation to a minimum, but in any case, thanks again. So the request to sort of understand better what are some of the legal threats, I took a really broad view in my survey of this to present to you. So again, it's not terribly narrow. And I've already gone over some of this slide, but I think one of the reasons why it's important to know what's going on from a broad perspective around policy that might implicate encryption is because it is under threat in a lot of different places, actually, not just sort of the overt legal challenges we see in the EU most recently, but also the US and UK pretty regularly. The Global Encryption Coalition is a group of civil society organizations for the most part, although we do have small companies that are members as well. Mostly they're implementers and providers, right? So that coalition has been spun up to do essentially this, to monitor the global landscape around policy that implicates encryption. It's steered by three main organizations. That's ISOC, Global Partners Digital, based in the UK, and then CDT. And some of you have probably heard of the Global Encryption Coalition. There actually might be some of you that are advisors to it. We have both organizational members, small companies as members, and technical specialists that are not a small figure or number of the members are in that category. And it's really critical to make sure that our interventions are technically grounded. We also started last year Global Encryption Day. So mark your calendars for the 21st of October, 2022. This is actually a video. I'm not going to play it, but it's just a bit of a overview of what Global Encryption Coalition does. And you can see our website at globalencryption.org. So I'm not going to take the sport metaphor terribly far, but I do think that it's useful to look at different categories around what kinds of policy for the last 20 plus years we've seen come around to challenge encryption for a variety of reasons. One bucket is really just kind of the mundane sort of controls, I would say, more than policy. Those are things like import and export controls. Those can sometimes also lead to definitions in law, actually, of minimum or maximum key length. I find the minimum very interesting. The Philippines is the country that has a minimum key length on it. I think it's obviously aimed at like government agencies using encryption, right? And then other things related to licensing. So these are, I mention them because while it was pointed out at Real World Crypto, for example, that they're not necessarily going to ban encryption, they do make it harder to just come up with a product and start selling it off the shelf and exporting, getting people to use it. There are ways that you have to interface with the government, for example, the US government in particular around what you're doing and what kinds of what algorithm you're using and that sort of thing. So it can be a way to make it a little bit harder. Compelled decryption is really worth mentioning, but it's not going to be the subject of my talk. This is when someone's taken into custody and their device either has full disk encryption on it or their messages are stored on it with encryption, forcing that suspect to decrypt is called compelled decryption. There are laws that enable it, and there are far more laws protecting suspects from having to from being compelled to decrypt. It's a civil liberties issue, and that's why I mention it. It's the same of like not having to tattle on yourself, basically. So the most of what I'm going to talk about is the third bucket, which is a large variety of different approaches to the question of lawful intercept. So I would say, and we'll get into this, that actually some of these schemes go beyond sort of lawful intercept in the way that they are proposed to be actioned by large internet connected platforms, because they would in effect present a sort of mass surveillance capability. Lawful intercept typically is considered, if there's a target, if you know that there's a suspect or you're in the middle of investigation, you can get a warrant and you can listen or wiretap into one particular person or something like that. So that is where a lot of this policy falls. I have to give credit to Global Partners Digital for this map that they've created. You can do a web search for Global Partners Digital encryption, and this will certainly come up. It is a bit outdated, but it is the only best effort I've seen to actually try to map every country in the world on its policies related to encryption. And it's a useful place to go to get a baseline of what other countries have done, and also kind of who copycats who. That was one of the most revelatory parts of this exercise, was you see one country maybe having an idea around something, and then that sort of follows like a domino effect across a region. African Union is a really good example where things tend to be enacted based on trends, policy trends. Okay, so I also now want to talk a little bit about oblique policy challenges. So these are policies we're seeing that do not absolutely directly implicate encryption or talk even about encryption, but that would have an effect on encryption. And I tried to do a red, amber, green assessment of where I think that there are real problems, that there could go either way, and then actually opportunities out there for some of these oblique policy intersections. So the first one is around trust and safety. We see that as the sort of, I guess, phrase du jour of how to talk about content that we find terribly objectionable, and it's very sort of stark contrast, if you will. We don't want terrorist content. We don't want images that either depict or would endanger child safety. And so these are, again, like they often don't have anything to do with encryption, but because they require a degree of content moderation on platforms, they can in effect implicate encryption if there aren't explicit carve-outs. But again, a law that doesn't have anything to do with encryption, creating an encryption carve-out is tricky. One, policymakers don't want to create a carve-out. And two, now you have a law that mentions encryption before you did not, right? So this is one that's really, really tricky. Cybercrime. So cybercrime ostensibly shouldn't be dealing with content issues again, but they do so because traditionally anyway, cybercrime has included intellectual property concerns. Civil society organizations would really rather they not, but nonetheless, that's what the Budapest Convention updates have done. Also criminal law then sometimes can sweep up encryption because there's a perception that crimes are more easily committed at scale and enabled with the use of encryption. So some of that is some myth busting that needs to be done. And then lastly, I actually think that there's an opportunity in cybercrime treaties because obviously cybercrime is specifically crimes related to computers. There's some computer component. I mean, obviously in the digital age, anything can be a cybercrime because we are sort of using computers for everything. That is an explicit, that is a trend that policymakers in this space are explicitly trying to avoid. But what is completely fully in scope, right, is computer systems and attacks on those. And so I think that there is an opportunity. I don't know whether or not we'll actually achieve this, but to make a case for strong encryption so as to protect systems and in particular governments from hacking and things like that. The third area of intersection is around human rights. So you have a lot of policy out there or policy trends out there that are designed to protect free expression, free speech, the right to association and the right to information. I put right to information and sort of censorship, if you will, or anti-censorship in that, because I think that from a technical perspective, they're really rather two sides of the same coin. If you can't tell who someone is or what they're looking at, it's very hard to prevent them from getting the information that they need. Information security, I haven't read because it's a phrase, information security versus cybersecurity, for example, that has it is a bit tricky because it will, as we've been saying in the last two buckets, include content. It is it's an information-centric framing around an issue that really should be about, general security. Information security brings to light things like misinformation, disinformation, much, much fuzzier terms and much more difficult things to moderate for, as opposed to those at the top, like terrorism or child content. Or child safety content. The opportunities here, and this is what a lot of civil society organizations protecting encryption lean on, is constitutional law and the human rights frameworks for combating threats to encryption. Simply saying that it's not proportional, that it infringes on other rights, and that balance hasn't been struck with mass surveillance and things like that. Leading to another human right, which is the right to privacy. In Europe, there's a lot of discussion, and the phrase typically is data protection. And then I also included in this data localization, which can sometimes get bucketed in these kinds of policies, but that maybe has more adverse effects than not. There's an opportunity here to define encryption, to define strong encryption, rather, because of the data protection elements. I would like to note that it's both content and behavior. So content and metadata, if you will. Some of the principles of data protection obviously are to minimize data, to not store data, to not log data, that sort of thing. And most end-to-end encrypted systems do that by default. It's an express design goal to not have the server know anything if possible. And so I think that, those are actually aligned. And again, when I was mentioning in the previous bucket, the proportionality argument is something that human rights lawyers really understand very well. It's expressed a lot more commonly now in data protection and privacy legislation, whereas any change, anytime you sort of violate the principles of data protection or right to privacy, it has to be proportional. There has to be a good reason for it. It needs to be necessary and proportionate. So leaning on those proportionality requirements to push back against invasive policy that would weaken encryption has been very effective, especially in Europe. And then lastly, I've also noticed recently that there are some competition related policies. This is dealing with user facing, basically looking after the will of the user and in the public interest, trying to deal with trust issues and competition in the tech space that are having, they have implications for interoperability across platforms, which I think presents a particular problem to encryption and especially end-to-end encryption, because currently we don't, from a technical perspective, have the sort of needed trust intermediaries that work across end-to-end encrypted messaging like you have with other kinds of global interoperable protocols. And so there's some catch-up that's needed. So at the moment, it feels like a bit like a threat, this idea that end-to-end encrypted messaging must be interoperable based on like the Digital Markets Act that just came out. But I think actually it is the right thing to do. We just have to catch up from a technical perspective so that there are no, you know, weak APIs that sort of solve that problem in the short term. Right. I wanted to maybe, let me just do a chime check. I'm going to go ahead and tell a few stories that sort of illustrate the way some of this has played out in the past. And give an idea of, you know, what's happening maybe outside our normal localized context. So one thing that I found interesting in looking at the traceability requirement that became popular in India and that was also proposed in Brazil and that also passed in Bangladesh was that the popular opinion sort of was against encryption, not because of online activity, which is what you find a lot here. You know, we talk about at scale crimes and how, you know, cross-border crimes can happen and so on. It's actually because of offline crime. So most of the country perhaps faces, real life, in-person, practical threats to safety and financial security and so on because of organized crime rings that are operating actually in a very offline way, but the narrative is that they're using encrypted messaging apps to organize themselves. So I found it really interesting, this idea of like the whole reason why folks were behind the sort of encryption traceability requirement was because there was this belief that you know, encrypted apps were helping thieves on the ground. In the traceability requirements, if you're not familiar with those, although probably you have, I like to think of them as enhanced metadata requirements, just that, you know, you've got a system that already operates to send messages from one place to another with end-to-end encryption. The proposal notably says it doesn't want the content. It just wants to know where the messages have come from. But of course, implied in all of that is that police officers or law enforcement and intelligence communities already have the content that they're looking for. Either it's been reported to them or they've seen it on a screenshot or something like that. Now they're looking for that message. So it's actually, while the law doesn't demand access to the content is taken as a given and the platforms are then requested to trace where that content's come from. So while the law sort of is talking about metadata, it does imply some access. The other thing about the enhanced metadata piece is that systems would have to change remarkably to be able to do this. So, you know, you've got a piece of content, perhaps you want to block it. Maybe you even ask users to report it and block it, and that's the way of tracing it. But that means now you're sort of hash matching everything going forward for blocked content. And you're also storing a lot more information about messages than you had previously. You're creating more data about it and you're storing more data about it. There's a lot of threats to social net mapping, for example, in traceability. In general, we are just very against it. And while India and Bangladesh both have laws in the books about it, they're both being challenged in court. Brazil's, as far as I know, hasn't gotten off the ground, but it's an election year there. And so probably not much is getting off the ground at the moment anyway. Okay, I think I'll move on to another one. There we go. So this this is a group of bloggers actually in Ethiopia, because quite some time ago, well, they're all out of prison now, but at one point they were in prison. These are you know, human rights bloggers. They're just really talking about politics in Ethiopia, and they were imprisoned, not supposedly because of what they said in their blogs, but because they were attending a workshop on how to use end-to-end encrypted messaging, and the government said that was a evidence that they were sort of clandestine spy group, and that is the official reason why they were put in jail. They're called the Zone 9 bloggers. This happened in 2014, and again, I use it as an example because while again it's an authoritarian regime, so it's not like the exception might prove the rule, but nonetheless, I think it is useful because there are quite a few countries that I have listed at the bottom here that have all sort of been places where end-to-end encrypted messaging or other kinds of secure apps haven't rolled out because of the threat, because of the risk that there's just such sort of unstable digital authoritarianism that it would actually put users at risk to have these products available there. So while, yes, it is for folks who are building these systems and also similarly trying to defend them in law. So right, in 2014, these folks attended, probably it was like PGP email workshop, because we all know it's relatively hard to do that. If you're teaching bloggers how to use encrypted email, it takes a day or two to get that down. Really routine stuff. I used to do the same when I worked at my previous job before Article 19, since Andrew mentioned it, was at the Association for Progressive Communications, which was headquartered in Johannesburg. And I spent a lot of those years doing digital security training for journalists, dissidents, activists, et cetera. Not an uncommon workshop to find. Very uncommon, though, to have everyone arrested for several years. It also similarly happened to friends in Turkey as well, not terribly long ago. So nonetheless, the idea here then is that with very little use of end-to-end encryption, it then has this, you know, not unlike the Bangladesh case, it has this sense from the public that, you know, if you're hiding something like that, then you must be doing something wrong. It's really easy to make that case and to get popular support for that view. So it was actually, this was a criminal code. And it has this sort of chilling effect or silencing effect where everyone else also in that sort of milieu is afraid to use it as well. So it really stifles adoption of what you need to actually just have, you know, basic, you know, everyday security for your banking and your talking to your loved ones, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, and then my last one, and then I think I should be done relatively soon to have more time for questions, happened in Zimbabwe. So this was also around that time. This was 2016. If you remember what happened in 2016, that is the year that WhatsApp rolled out end-to-end encryption to like so very many people because they already had so many people using it, especially in the global south. WhatsApp can be the way that people connect. So what happened was Mugabe was still in power. There were lots of people in Zimbabwe very unhappy with the economic climate in particular, really wanted him to go. Again, authoritarian reaction was, I'm going to stay and I'm going to punish you if you are organizing against me. The reason I mentioned this one is that I thought it was really interesting. Again, I was working at APC at the time, had several colleagues in Zimbabwe. We, you know, had relationships there. Folks were emailing me and others to ask, like, you know, is it possible that they can actually read our messages? Because that's what this says. So this it was printed out on pieces of paper and leafleted all over Harare and in other parts of Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe, where it says, you know, if you're talking about organizing on WhatsApp, you're going to be actioned, like we're going to take care of you. And there was just some uncertainty amongst protesters whether or not that was true, right? It was really scary for some people, because they did actually believe that like the end-to-end encryption could be disrupted by the Zimbabwe government. So what happened actually, another escalation of this conflict was that because people continued to use it, they just shut it down. So the government just stopped people from using WhatsApp entirely. And like I was saying before, like since 2014, almost everyone used it. I mean, that was equivalent of text messaging and internet use was the uses of WhatsApp. So folks, if you've ever lived in a country where WhatsApp is really pervasive, I mean, you use it for everything. You use it to make a doctor's appointment. You use it to order, delivery, like everything sort of happens. And so once a shutdown like this happened, it affected immediately the financial sector. It affected health and safety. People couldn't message their loved ones. Obviously, then it also affected quite strongly reporting and journalism, because there was no way to stay in contact with your sources and to actually know what was going on the other side of town and so on and so forth. So it was quite an ordeal. And I think that this story and encryption are interlinked. The fact that the government couldn't actually see what was happening on the app led to the shutdown. And that was, and this has happened in other places as well. Like you can't monitor it, you can't control it, so you just make it inaccessible. Right. So anyway, I'm going to wrap up here, but I think that I've mentioned these before, that some of the issues is that once one country sort of makes headway with a law that either obliquely or directly, forces end-to-end encrypted apps to change. Either that's because they have to log IP addresses more often, they have to do traceability, they have to do client-side scanning, et cetera. Those will take off. Pretty much every government really enjoy the ability to have access, even if it's just lawful access or sometimes access to content they would do. I think that there are a few things that I see civil society organizations continue to do. Is just at the narrative level, talk about why encryption is really critical, not just for dissidents and those with something, quote, to hide, but for everyone. I think we have to also spread out. So we've done a lot more surveying and following policies that, again, like don't explicitly mention encryption, but they have implications for it. So that's the second bucket. And then the last thing, which again, I didn't get into very much, but would be happy to talk about, is the civil liberties issues related to things like compelling decryption and client-side scanning. And those actually sometimes also mean that we're not just watching policy, we're actually watching implementers of end-to-end encryption so that they know that they don't need to overcomply and that they can sort of work with us to sort of fight these laws and that they shouldn't start changing their platforms now, because that would be counterproductive. So I think that's all I wanted to present, but looking forward to talking with you for a few more minutes.
Perfect. Thank you, Mallory. I'm sure that's provoked quite a lot of sort of thoughts. Hopefully we get some on either side of the debate, because that makes it far more interesting to have. Let me throw one at you and then we'll take questions from people. And I'm trying to make this as balanced as possible. So certainly in the UK, and I think other countries, boards have got responsibility for cybersecurity. So they should be interested in things like encryption from a non-technical point of view, just to secure the safety of the data and comply with things like GDPR, et cetera, which is all sort of positive. On the other hand, if you like, the downside of end-to-end encryption is if you can't see what data is going out of your company, you've got no idea about things like, you know, command and control of malware, or insider trading, or so on. So if you like, there seems to be a bit of a dichotomy there between you know, the security positives of encryption and actually that, you know, if the wrong people, if you will, are using it, you know, it, I suppose it's like a gun, isn't it? You can use it for both good and bad things. So striking the balance, I think, seems to me to be a particular challenge here. How you can protect both sides of the discussion. I don't know if you want to comment on that at all, whether there's where you see the balance can best be struck to protect the sort of privacy and security, etc.
Sure. Well, that's interesting because I think that within a business context, so, you know, you're controlling your employees, you're controlling the intranets they use, their use of the internet. I feel like it's perfectly fine if you want a culture in which you know, everyone should expect that their, you know, inter-office communications are monitored, even if you're using strong encryption, right? Because you are yourself trusting yourself, you know, you're trusting the business to do you know, machine in the middle or other kinds of intermediary services. I think that's perfectly fine. I think actually where businesses need to be very worried is any kind of like external, right, communications. I would assume that would really sort of force the issue for companies to actually be okay with this idea of end-to-end encryption, because then, you know, you have a lot, your surface area, your attack area is a lot, attack surface, sorry, is a lot more weak in those cases. So while you can go ahead and create all the intermediaries you want, ETLS, you know, messaging apps that can be decrypted with central server keys, that makes sense. I think where it's external is it's trickier probably. And yeah, I think it's a double-edged sword. Well, again, businesses can do what they want. What we're concerned about is when governments say that this should be all people that reside in a certain country, or any application that is operating and there are enough users from this country, they have to abide by certain platform. And so while we've seen some special accommodations in the encryption space made for certain countries, like for example, I think, you know, Mozilla had like a really critical DNS privacy feature go to everyone else but the UK, because they said that they wouldn't do that. They're for the most part, we view those platform changes to be weakening overall. So even if you only deploy it in a certain way for a certain area, like you're now weakening your system in sort of fundamental ways. It's similar to the interoperability question around, like, if I have two apps and one is backdoored and the other one still maintains strong encryption, they have to interoperate. What are some of the tricky issues related to that? And can we make sure that it stays strong? These are all really, really big questions. And I think that in general, having to have a complicated system when end-to-end encryption group chats, for example, are already so very difficult, has the effect of creating a space in which strong implementations of end-to-end encryption are, there's a really, really high bar to make sure that they're strong.
Yeah, understood. Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. I can see Pat, you've got your hand raised. So you want to come on?
Yeah, hi there. Thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thanks for the presentation, Mallory. Just out of interest, in your presentation slides, you depict the UK as being amber. And apologies to the non-UK call participants here today, very UK-centric. I was intrigued to understand what precisely renders the UK as being amber, and indeed patches of the EU, again, also amber. Can you expand on that a bit?
Absolutely. From the UK? Yeah, I think actually the most prominent anti-encryption legislation that's out at the moment, it's all coming from Europe, European countries, the EU, and the UK. So in order, that is right. Belgium had a law not too long ago that would have compelled or that would have forced backdoors. They took that off the table, but now there's a new one that sort of requests all OTT to do IP logging, which would be very aggressive for end-to-end encrypted apps that don't log IP addresses. The EU just proposed a sort of child sexual abuse material scanning regime that would require all applications, including end-to-end encrypted messages, to scan for content. So any kind of content scanning is going to obviously violate end-to-end encryption, no matter where you do it, if it's on device or if it's on a server, it's just not encrypted anymore. Though, if I remember right, the UK has had several, and I sort of tend to lose track, but I know that not long ago, maybe this is less a policy thing, but it is a really nice example nonetheless. They'd spent maybe not a huge amount, but a significant sum on an advertising campaign to sort of weaken encryption in the larger narrative, talking about how, you know, criminals can go dark and so on. And that, I think, was as recent as like February. The UK online safety bill, I believe, threatens encryption in oblique, if not direct ways. And so, you know, while we like to talk, while we like to think that this is an issue for authoritarians that want to lock up, you know, journalists using encryption, actually a lot of the main threats are coming from countries that can control, because of their markets, they can control what WhatsApp is doing, what Facebook is doing, what, you know, and those are the apps that the whole world uses that have billions and billions of people on them, only some of which reside in the UK, the US, Europe, et cetera. I mean, the US, I'll throw it in just so that we're not, you're not feeling called out on that side of the Atlantic, but the US also has had several legislation. The Earn It Act is still on the table, although it hasn't moved for a few months, but that also explicitly carves out.
Okay, so to recap then, from the UK perspective, and apologies to other callers, other participants, it's scrutinised in Parliament, and I think it remains to be seen actually what the practical effect will be. But just as a footnote, I suppose really for me, I'm you know, my background in security, so you can spin up an encrypted network connection between point A and point B, but the client, if you ask that you install antivirus software before something, you know, is accessed or put into memory, triggers a signature or heuristics, flags it as viral, that's a protective step. So you can take the alternative argument that actually something with consent, where people sign up to it and they're quite relaxed about it, it's an end user choice. So, but yeah, I understand now what you're saying. Thanks very much for clarifying.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that consent piece is absolutely critical. And also, I would say not just consent, but default. What's the default setting? And can we make it opt in rather than opt out? That's a really important one.
Yeah. Just as a footnote, I do remember content encryption, de-encryption for DVDs, and how that source code ended up on T-shirts. So we shall see. Anyway, thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Pat. Marwin, I think, had his hand raised next.
Hi, Mallory. I'm really glad you're here. I'm going to ask you a tough question.
Sure.
Okay. And for the room, because I always land in the hot seat when I say this, but I have yet to find a reasonable way to deal with it. So I will note, like, forget end runs and all of the rest. I think Chris Witt is in the room, and I've had this conversation with him as well in the past. Though I might be wrong, I would wager that there has never been a time in human history where communications on common infrastructure have been completely opaque. And for me, it's less about, you know, what's the end run? Is it safety? Is it security? And all of the rest. But there, like, this is a fundamental, like, society has been built on this notion that communications have never been opaque on common infrastructure. And I don't know what the response is to that or how to deal with it.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. I see a very similar view that's coming from the other side, perhaps. I don't think there's sides necessarily, but I think another trend is that never before have all of our communications had to be on the network. I mean, it used to be you could have a private conversation walking down the street with your friend, or at standing next to a water fountain. We had a robust offline world in which we communicated with the people we loved the most, the people we had to trust the most, whether they're lawyers, doctors, so on. And especially now with the pandemic, it should be very obvious how much of that has now moved online, how much of our everyday exchanges, big, small, you know, and they're all online. So I think this is more why we need to make sure that not 100% or near total amount of our daily communications could be filtered. That is the risk, I think. And that is something that really chills people to the core when you talk about how, you know, now you're just sort of mundane exchanges with those in your life are potentially passing through all kinds of filters and middle boxes. And that's just not a world I think we want to live in.
Thank you.
Yeah, this is sort of the panopticon, I guess, as a scenario. Okay, thank you, Marwen. That was an interesting question. Peter, you had your hand raised next.
Hi. Thanks, Mallory, for the presentation. That was great. I had a question. I saw this question raised before. I don't know if it's ever been answered. Is there actually a good definition of what end-to-end encryption really means exactly?
It's a really, really good question. I have the same issue. And so I tried to actually write a draft in IETF about it, and it's sort of moving around. This is really critical, actually. We need to have a common understanding of an end-to-end encrypted system. And then I think there are other features that maybe tend to be associated with end-to-end encryption, but maybe aren't mission critical, right? Things like perfect forward secrecy is kind of what we've come to assume to be part of end-to-end encryption, but there are ways in which perhaps, you know, end-to-end encrypted systems could be used without it. Deniability is another one. Like, deniability is a really nice feature, but it is so complicated to implement. It is so difficult to square that circle with a bunch of other, trade-offs, that it's hard enough that a lot of end-to-end encrypted systems don't use it. Does that mean that it's less secure? Does it mean that we don't call it end-to-end encryption? I don't know. But I do agree with you, Peter, that we have to come up with what it means, because when we then require that end-to-end encrypted systems interoperate with one another, we ought to have a baseline to compare, right? Is Telegram really the same as Signal? I mean, are they actually apples to apples? I don't know that that's true, actually, because we don't really know how Telegram works or what some of its principal technical features are. But yeah, I would agree that we have to do that. So there's a draft, like I said, in the IETF about trying to define it from three perspectives. One is just a formal definition. What's an end? We dive really deep into what an end is, because we'd like to think that I'm the end, not my device, especially if it's scanning things on my behalf that I maybe don't know about. The other aspect of it is features, like I just mentioned. And then the third aspect is user expectations. Most end users who would really benefit from encryption don't know what deniability is. They don't care what perfect forward secrecy is, yada, yada, yada. But they do probably imagine that when they're using it, nobody else can see what they're saying. And that's maybe a very shorthand way of describing something that's really pretty profound from a technical perspective.
Thanks.
Thanks, Peter. I can see Pat's posted a suggested definition in the chat for anyone that's interested. Giovanni, you raised your hand next.
Thank you, Andrew. And thank you, Mallory, for the nice presentation. A question about how data privacy is managed in Europe and for European customers or people in general, because I think you work a lot in the civil society area. So in Europe, GDPR says that my information, my data, my personal data is equal to my human rights. So let's say if I buy the services from a company, then that company resell my address, my telephone number to another company, then they violate not only my personal data, they violate my privacy, and they have violated my human rights. And there are big, big penalties that you're aware of that. In the United States, if a United States company provides a service to a European, they basically have to follow the same rules for European customers. They moved from Safe Harbor to Privacy Shield. and they adhere now. But for US customers, for US people in the end, it's not the same. So in Europe, we have the automatic opt-out, which means that automatically, if I purchase some services, then automatically I'm opting out, which means I am not agreeing automatically to share my data. In the United States, as far as I remember, it's completely the opposite. So if I go to the United States, I get a SIM card from a US company, which can be Virgin, anything. Automatically, if I don't take any actions, they can resell my data. So do you think that, a couple of questions, do you think that the United States is learning a lesson from Europe about this? So United States company have to adhere to the GDPR. They already moved from Safe Harbor to Public Shield. So are they learning something? And the government is learning something from Europe for once. Are they going to push these restrictions to United States companies for local users? And second question, where is the world moving? Now, we have a lot of, I would say, fun of GDPR all over the world. Some of the countries or continents are following and creating some legislations for data privacy that is more similar to GDPR. What is the trend worldwide? You probably know a lot more than me on this. Mm-hmm. Are other continents moving towards Europe in this, or are they staying with the PII-like rules and regulations similar to the United States?
Yeah, these are really good questions. They're really big questions. And I would just say that, the feeling in civil society in the US is that the US has been behind on privacy legislation for way too long. And it doesn't seem that anything is dislodging that. It's a very frustrating situation for us. But yes, there's a law in California that I think is an attempt, but probably doesn't go far enough. There are several states, actually, a lot of them are sort of more right-wing states because of this, sort of personal liberty piece to it. So that's heartening, but we're not quite sure that they've gone far enough. And obviously we need a fully federal solution. I do think that, yes, we see, like, actually, I think one of the best laws that was inspired by the GDPR, well, it's not a law, but it's a policy document in the AU, the Cybersecurity and Data Protection. I think it's a model law, essentially, and it's only been ratified by maybe 13 of the 54 states in the African Union. But it's particularly good, and it protects encryption, goes far. So I do think that there was a time when, Europe, the GDPR was copycatted and maybe even improved upon. I do see, though, that there are some examples where, and maybe the US is one, where GDPR has been copycatted on and slightly weakened. I also think that within the EU, there are threats to GDPR itself. I mean, the Brussels law that I was mentioning before about IP logging is disproportionate. It certainly does not pass the bar for disproportionality to require all OTT services to be logging IP addresses. That's just straight up antithetical. So I think it's one of those things. Maybe it's because I've worked my whole career in civil society. We are going to always be seeing sort of threats, big and small, to these issues over and over and over again. Just because you have something really good in place like GDPR doesn't mean it doesn't get eroded. And you also may need to get the whole sort of ecosystem to catch up, or you will still have businesses doing the wrong thing. And you have this weird, like you mentioned, this sort of mismatch between an opt-in and an opt-out regime that then, de-preferences people that live in places with strong privacy laws. So I just want to echo that you're right about all this. And I wish I could give you the 101, but that might be another 30-minute presentation.
In my humble opinion, I think South America is very interesting in this. It's a little bit like an indicator. Mm. There are some countries that naturally follow United States in this, and mm-hmm. some other countries that are taking a stance, differently. For example, yeah. Argentina, if I'm not mistaken, what I read in the past, they're following some very GDPR-like approach. Mm-hmm. So I think, South America can be a good indicator for where the world could, but this is just my two cents.
I do agree.
So obviously, you know, probably much more than me about the topic.
I wish I knew more. I do agree that it's an interesting continent for sure, because it's just such a mix of different approaches. Like you said, there's those that follow the US, there's those that follow Europe, and then there's a whole lot of fascist countries still that are doing.
We always talk about Europe and United States, like bipolar, you know, but I think South America can be maybe an indication where the rest of the world can go, obviously, mm-hmm. not counting China, Russia, those are other things.
That's right.
Well, thank you, Mallory.
Thanks.
Some interesting points. I think Brazil is also doing some interesting stuff on GDPR activity as well. Right, last question goes to Arno. So Arno, do you want to jump in?
Yeah, thank you. Hi, Mallory. So you can expect what's going to be my approach to that, right? So, you know, just as a reminder, I was born French, even though I'm Swiss, right? And I was born with the human rights in my veins. And I wish it would work like, you know, encryption is the solution to the whole problem. Unfortunately, it's not, because here we are only looking at one aspect of it. Of course, mass surveillance is bad. Well, absolutely, it's bad. Absolutely bad. Right? But I live in Switzerland. I expect my country and my police to find the bad guys. I trust them, right? Because we are one country where we believe we are trustable. And so I have no problem in my country doing lawful interception in the warrants for specific people, no, not a mass surveillance, but just exactly that. I absolutely expect them to do. If 10 dirty bombs would drop on Geneva tomorrow and would kill everybody I like, I would expect my government to actually do the right thing there. So it's just to take a little bit of distance of what do we mean by that. Yes, I understand completely China and plenty of bad countries who have done horrible things, absolutely. But the problem that I have is that it's too easy, right? It's only one side of the street to say, oh, we encrypt everything. Middle boxes are bad. They are weakening things. But unfortunately, you cannot trust the two ends of the communication. And you can do as much as you want. You cannot trust the browser. Think about manning the browser attack. So how are you going to find a way that is not judge and party in a story where privacy cannot trust security? Yes, it's true. It cannot trust it because it has to give something away to a party that it cannot trust because we cannot prove security. And at the same time, privacy needs security. Otherwise, it cannot prove it's private. So the problem is that we have two zealots. We have the zealots of the privacy side and you've got the zealots of the security side. But we are not as wise as the physicist. The physicist took 100 years to understand quantum states. They are together. You cannot remove them. I wish we could, but it doesn't work like this. It's not the nature of things. So when people are encrypted, fantastic, but the protocols are now making a highway from the server side to the client side to download also sorts of including malware. How are you going to protect them? How are you going to protect a man in the browser attack? You need to read everything on the page to protect the people and say, no, don't click here, stop.
Right.
So I really have a problem with a little bit the sterile approach that it's always the privacy guys are on the good side and the security guys are always the bad guys. I mean, can we stop that and just try to think a bit different type of solutions? Because we could find other type of solutions, I think, but we are just not talking.
Yeah. So I certainly don't think that privacy and security are opposed. I think that if you put people at the center, then they're in perfect harmony almost. And because, you know, you also need encryption as a type of security, data security as a type of privacy and security. So anyway, but that's not really what I wanted to say. I wanted to say that I think encryption is kind of, at this point, I hate to say, it just is. It exists. It's a technology. It's not really going away. And while you can sort of regulate it or come in and create some requirements for like the really big apps like, you know, Facebook or WhatsApp because they have the most users, it's still going to exist. So I see it more as like, I really just wish sort of law enforcement and the intelligence community would kind of lay off because they're the ones that I find really solutionist in all of this. You know, I've talked to a lot of child protection groups in the past about trying to understand where they're coming from. They are often not technical, as you can imagine. They are kind of told that, you know, encryption is the enemy. Whereas one of them actually was very frank. She said, when I found out WhatsApp was encrypting its messages, I was so grateful because I talk to my cases, my youth at risk all the time. And now they're going to be a lot more at ease that they can talk to me and we can message about things because our communications are secure. Now she's changed her mind. She's now been convinced by law enforcement in her community that encryption is what is putting kids at risk. And I would say that that is also, that's not true. I think that we couldn't at all reduce such a serious social crime to the use of a technology. And similarly, backdooring WhatsApp doesn't save the children. That's a solutionist thinking. It's not even just that if you had access to the content that you could stop abuse. It's that it isn't just access to the content. You would need continual access. So you would need kind of access at a constant level to conduct investigations. You would need to store that somewhere. Probably WhatsApp's going to be the place that stores it, not the law enforcement. You know, you need, I mean, even had one law enforcement agent say that one of the goals of their policy was that so they could maybe take images, run facial recognition on them, and then intervene directly with victims. And I just thought to myself, that is not something that we should be putting in policy, that we should be asking police officers to do. And who wants as a victim to have their face now encoded in images? So I'm using an extreme example to explain that I think the solutionism has been coming from law enforcement that feel that they just need to be able to have access to anything all the time. And anything that they aren't able to is going to need to be fixed. Because again, like encryption's out there, it's not going away. We need to make sure that it's strong for people who are victimized as well, because it protects their communications depending on, you know, who they're actually at risk from.
You can imagine I passed that point. I understand what you are saying. I'm not at all at that level. Of course, we do not want that. But on the other side, when you are on the more, let's say, other parts, it's like we are not able to heal two sides. And sometimes for really wrong reasons, when you really dig behind the scenes of the interests of some companies versus the real interests of privacy and security.
Just to wrap up, maybe I could offer two ways that I think this healing could happen, because I agree with you. I think the first way is that we really have to deal with the security issue that you and others have already brought up, because it's slowing adoption of encryption. That's my issue, is if you are running a system and you can't be sure that you can keep it safe because you're using encryption, you're not going to use encryption, right? And I don't want that to be the case. I want there to be solutions such that encryption is a foregone conclusion, and we've sort of got some best practices around how to deal with the security issues. That's the first one. The second one is, I think that from a societal harms perspective, so bringing in law enforcement and intelligence communities again, I think we have to take breaking encryption and backdooring encryption off the table and look at, get better at some of the things that can happen on top of it. So if we could just like relax, because I spend a lot of time dealing with this and I shouldn't have to. There's a lot more interesting questions or things that we could be doing in terms of using technology to save folks that might be inoculated with a terrorist's ideas or children that might be being abused across borders. There are way more interesting problems, but because we have to keep having this like very basic encryption debate for the last 20 years, we can't get at those problems. So let's just take it off the table and start building tech solutions on top of it as if it exists. And I think that, especially if it's a lawful end. And anyway, I want to just thank you all, because we went way over it and you didn't even get to the rest of your agenda, but obviously it's because the conversation is so interesting.
That's great. I knew it was going to be an interesting topic. So thank you, Mallory. I'll maybe throw in perhaps a topic that we need to come back to, because we focus a lot of our attention on encryption and government. Where I think we ought to just remind ourselves that probably most of the surveillance that most of us suffer from currently is more likely to be at the hands of some of the social media companies, let's say, without being too specific. So surveillance is a complex topic, and the tech sector is both possibly the solution to it, but also one of its worst the worst offenders. But there you are. That's a discussion for another time. So thank you, Mallory, for sort of running through that. That's much appreciated. I'm just going to very quickly cover a couple of other topics, but we will finish by 10 past the hour as per the chat. So I'll just reshare my screen briefly. I just wanted to highlight a couple of recent developments, just until the top of the screen. One is DNS over QUIC. The RFC 9250 was published a week or so ago. So fantastic achievement by Sarah and Alison and colleagues, no doubt with many of contributors, but it is now a standard officially. So you're aware of that. The other thing I wanted to just reference, which maybe we'll come back to at some other time, you may have seen the announcement from Microsoft that of the Azure DNS private resolver is now in preview. So that's maybe something we'll revisit at a later date. I just wanted to highlight those two specifically. Plenty of other news, but maybe that's for another time. In terms of forthcoming events, I wanted to signpost that later on this week, on Wednesday, a DNS filter running a DNS unfiltered. So if any of you haven't registered for that and are interested, the link is available. So that will be worth a look, I'm sure. Plenty of other stuff running through the next few months. Probably the other one to mention is the early bird rate for DNS 114 runs out in 2 weeks. So if you're likely to want to register, particularly in person, it's worth getting the early bird rate. That's a significant discount. I think it's $175, if I remember rightly, or $150, something like that. So if you're going to register, register soon. That's coming up. And then finally, to run through these rapidly, in terms of DNS over QUIC, rather timely, Andre Meshkov from AbGuard is joining us this time next week to just share some of AbGuard's experiences of running a DOQ resolver and having client software available for the last, I think, 15, 18 months, maybe more. So that's going to be particularly timely with the standard just having been ratified. A few things I'm trying to line up, just finalising dates. So in particular, we should have a presentation from one of Peter's colleagues in DNS Filter about protective DNS, DNS encryption and zero trust. In the next few weeks, and also from Jeff Huston of APNIC on a resolveless DNS. I should say that Jeff's session probably won't be at this time, so I'll need to adjust the time to be sympathetic to Jeff living in Canberra and not being especially anxious to be on the call at 3 a.m. or something. So I will flag as soon as I can, once we finalise that session, exactly when it is, just so you're aware. And then finally, third point down on that list, on the back of the panel discussion from last week, which seemed to go really well, I'm going to see if we can schedule a second one, again with some resolver operators, but also some of the software companies. So if you'd like to be involved in that, please contact me directly, let me know, and we'll get a few more companies in terms of resolver operators, but also, if I can, some of the software companies as well, to give a different perspective on some of the stuff that's either has happened or is in the pipeline that will be of interest. Okay, that's everything for me. So just quickly see, is there anything in anyone else wants to raise before we wrap up the call? So just if you do, just quickly jump in now. Otherwise, I will close the call. And I will pick up some of the stuff in the chat and put that into the notes, so that won't be completely lost, just so you're aware. Right, I'm not seeing any hands raised, so sorry we've run over slightly, but I think that was an extremely useful chat, so it's worth doing. So thank you, everyone, for your time. Have a fabulous week, and look forward to seeing you on the call with Andre to talk about all things DOQ this time next week. So have a great week, everyone. Thank you all.